I worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Let the whole earth stand in awe of him. Dearly beloved brethren, the scripture moves us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we most chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary, as well for the body as for soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace, saying after me, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done, and there is no help in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable members. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind, in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for this sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, and have given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people being penitent the absolution and remission of their sins. Pardoneth and absolveth all them that truly repent and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him in which we do it for his present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. them for which we sit.
Thank you. Here begins the third chapter of the book of Joshua. Early in the morning, Joshua rose and set out from Shittim with all the Israelites, and they came to the Jordan. They camped there before crossing over. At the end of 3 days, the officers went through the camp and commanded the people, "When you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God being carried by the Levitical priests, then you shall set out from your place. Follow it, so that you may know the way you should go, for you have not passed this way before. Yet there shall be a space between you and it, a distance of about 2,000 cubits. Do not come any nearer to it." Then Joshua said to the people, "Sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you." To the priests, Joshua said, "Take up the Ark of the Covenant and pass on in front of the people." So they took up the Ark of the Covenant and went in front of the people. The Lord said to Joshua, "This day I will begin to exalt you in the sight of all Israel, so that they may know that I will be with you as I was with Moses. You are the one who shall command the priests who bear the Ark of the Covenant. When you come to the edge of the waters of the Jordan, you shall stand still in the Jordan." When the people set out from their tents to cross over the Jordan, the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant were in front of the people. Now the Jordan overflows all its banks throughout the time of harvest. So when those who bore the Ark had come to the Jordan, and the feet of the priests bearing the Ark were dipped in the edge of the water, the waters flowing from above stood still, rising up in a single heap far off at Adam, the city that is beside Zarethan, while those flowing towards the sea of Araba, the Dead Sea, were wholly cut off. Then the people crossed over opposite Jericho. While all Israel were crossing over on dry ground, the priests who bore the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stood on dry ground in the middle of the Jordan until the entire nation finished crossing over the Jordan. So ends the first reading.
We start with Magnificat.
Resort of magnificence. Here begins the letter to the Hebrews. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. But in these days, he has spoken to us by a Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being. And he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, "You are my Son, today I have begotten you"? Or again, "I will be his Father, and he will be my Son"? And again, when he brings the firstborn into the world, he says, "Let all God's angels worship him." Of the angels, he said, "He makes his angels winds and his servant flames of fire." But of the Son, he says, "Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. And the righteous scepter is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions." And in the beginning, Lord, you founded the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. They will wear out like clothing. Like a cloak, you will roll them up, and like clothing, they will be changed. But you are the same, and your years will never end. So ends the second reading.
We start with unbelievers.
Thank you. Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee, we being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness. Through the merits of Jesus Christ our Saviour.
Oh.
I speak and may you hear in the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I have come to drag you out of yourself and to take you in my heart. I have come to bring out the beauty you never knew you had and lift you like a prayer to the sky. So writes the poet and mystic Rumi, writing over 800 years ago. The season of Epiphany is one which enables us to reflect more deeply on the mystery of the Incarnation, the birth of God in our world. It gives us a change in tone, in contrast to the season of Christmas, and draws us out of draws us into a complementary strand of thinking. If Christmas is familiar, homely, and domestic with its carols, crib services, and celebrations, Epiphany invites the other, that which is strange, into our lives, whether that's in the form of the travellers visiting from afar, or the sign at Cana of the water being turned into wine. God is doing something new, and we are aware of its newness because it is strange. Perhaps that's why Epiphany can offer us so much in this new year, which brings us more experiences that disorientate, confuse, worry, and stretch us. A textile artist called Judy Martin says that what we can't control, can't think through, and is unnameable is an experience of the sublime. I think there's something in that. We don't get to name God. He names us. We think of God naming John the Baptist, of demanding obedience from Zechariah. Such a precursor to Jesus' birth is instructive. God is drawing attention to himself. At Christmas and into Epiphany, we see God doing the new thing proclaimed in Isaiah. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it, Isaiah says. Perhaps it's time we should take notice. Epiphany means manifestation or appearance. It's an appearance or glimpse of God, but it is essentially just a glimpse. God's glory isn't constantly manifested to us. It's something very special, an extraordinary moment, one to wonder at and consider, but not to be grasped or contained or controlled. Mary, throughout her life, seems to realize that her son should be listened to and obeyed. She spends time encouraging others to do what he says when she is once again facilitating Epiphany moments. I have come to drag you out of yourself and take you in my heart. I have come to bring out the beauty you never knew you had and lift you like a prayer to the sky. Signs are not about achieving anything. They are not there to complete a task. Rather, they are there to make us notice something. What we pay attention to will come to define us. And the signs of Epiphany tell us that we should pay attention to Jesus. We should notice him. At the wedding feast in Cana, Jesus didn't perform his first miracle so that the wedding guests could get drunk. He didn't do it to be helpful or a good guest. What has that got to do with me? He first responds to his mother when she tells him that the host has run out of wine. then he realizes he can take the opportunity to reveal something. He can turn this moment into a sign. A sign that something new is happening. Everyone serves the good wine first, but you have kept the best till last, the steward says. God's goodness and generosity hasn't run out. Indeed, his goodness and generosity has just gone up a level. We haven't seen anything yet, as they say in the movies. God is revealing his glory through his Son. And at his baptism, Jesus is obedient to the call of John to repent. And so God reveals him to be his Son, the Beloved, in whom he is well pleased. Glory is another word that is truly mysterious. What is God's glory? It's nothing like we know on earth. It's not at all like the vain glory that we see humans seek in fame or status or fortune or renown or success. God's glory is rather to be seen in his self-emptying. John's Gospel narrates long passages of Jesus talking about glory with his Father. One such is this: "The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may be completely one, so that the world may know that you have sent me and loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that those also whom you have given me may be with me where I am, to see my glory, which you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world." Such a passage is often painful for us humans to hear because of the judgment that it casts over our own self-serving actions. But God's glory is shared and serves the purposes of love and nothing else. God shares his glory through his Son, so that we too might be participators in his glory, that we might be unified with the Father and the Son and with each other. Perhaps then the Epiphany signs of baptism, of magi, of turning water into wine, reveal that Jesus' glory is to be shared and enjoyed, that his glory is people joyfully partaking together in the heavenly banquet. But then we only get a glimpse, for it's beyond us, and yet that moment of epiphany is enough to inspire a lifetime of belief and a desire to keep searching on. Rumi wrote, "I have come to drag you out of yourself and take you in my heart. I have come to bring out the beauty you never knew you had and lift you like a prayer to the sky." This epiphany, let us strive to glimpse God in these fleeting manifestations. Let us strive to do our part, like Mary, in enabling God incidences, where something of God's self, his presence and his grace, are revealed to the people we meet. And let us strive to be bearers of the light we have received through baptism, to illuminate the path ahead of ourselves and for all people. Amen. We sing the hymn, "Songs of Praise the Angels Sang."
So praise the angels, sing, and we are.
season of Epiphany. Let us give thanks to God for the manifestation of our Lord Jesus Christ and the wise men, through his baptism in the Jordan by John, and through his first miracle in Cana of Galilee. Let us pray for the Church, that she may faithfully continue to proclaim and make manifest her Lord and Saviour to all people, both near and far. Almighty God, hear the hymns of joy which we offer to thee for the gift of thy dear Son. Give to us and to all thy faithful people grace and courage to proclaim thy mighty works in Christ, in the crib and on the cross, and in the world today. And may we and all thy Church work together in proclaiming the good news found in him who is the world's Redeemer and Prince of Peace, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. On this Sunday of the baptism of Christ, when we give thanks for his baptism and for the revelation from God that Jesus is his Son, let us pray for those preparing to be baptized or confirmed this year, for those who are baptized today, for those who are new to their Christian faith and whose faith is seeking understanding, and for those who are struggling in their faith. And Lord our God, who didst promise to them that love thee the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord, we commend to thee those who seek thy grace in the sacraments of initiation. Let thy fatherly hand be ever over them. Let thy Holy Spirit be ever with them, daily increasing them thy manifold gifts of grace, that they may continue thine forever, until they come at last to thine everlasting kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for the Church of God, wherever she may be found, for the healing of her divisions and pains, and for all who strive to reunite the fractured body of Christ, as we prepare for the week of prayer for Christian unity, which begins this week. Almighty God, who willest that all thy children should be one in thee, we pray thee for the unity of thy Church. Pardon all our pride and lack of faith, our lack of understanding and of charity, which are the cause of our divisions. Deliver us from narrow-mindedness, from bitterness and from prejudice. Preserve us from considering as normal that which is a scandal to the world and an offence to thy love. And teach us to recognise the gifts of thy grace amongst all those who call upon thee. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The psalmist writes, as we heard in our psalms this evening, God is our hope and strength, a very present help in trouble. Let us pray for those who are in despair or trouble this night. For all who feel the effect of natural disasters, failed harvests, and the destruction and turmoil caused by war. For those who are sick in body, mind, or spirit. For all who are laid low with grief, that they may each in their distress and pain may know the hope and strength of God. Almighty God, who didst at this time give thy only Son to be the light of hope shining in the world, so that we might have hope, Have mercy on all who are in despair and who live in fear. For all whom life has lost its meaning and for whom hope has become extinct. Come to them in pity and power to renew their faith and hope. Strengthen them with thy loving presence and enable them to honour thee by believing that thou art able to make all things new. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And finally, let us commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God this night, as we say together, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all evermore. And sing our final hymn, Hail to the Lord's Anointed.
Perfect in you the image of his glory,
and gladden your hearts with the good news of his kingdom. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.